introduction you have, and it's all sold out. Thank you for coming. It's good to be back in Lund. We live in turbulent times, but I guess you have been living in more turbulent times than most people here in Sweden. I was glad I could make it here in the storm and that you also survived. Great to be back in Lund. I will speak English on request because of the international students. I hope it's okay. But I will hopefully speak for not more than 45 minutes. And then I would very much look forward to questions or comments that you may have. Och dessa frågor och kommentarer kan ni också ställa på svenska om ni vill, so that we are truly bilingual here. And I think that most of you will be able to follow this in the new lingua franca, which is English. So let me proceed and say that I was very gratified for this introduction, generous introduction of Karin. I have spent a lot of time in mediation, conflict resolution, and it has become a little bit like a drug in my veins. I'm starting to get dependent on this. My wife tells me I have to stop. Can't continue like this. She goes so far to the extent that if I'm not in the best of mood on a Friday night, normally we are in a good mood on a Friday night, if I'm not in the best of mood, she looks at me and says, Jan, didn't you have enough crisis this week? So it has become a little bit of a, by the way, could you also turn off your cell phones? I'm just turning off mine now. You mentioned my experience in mediation, and yes, it goes back to 31 years back. It started in 1980. It was Olof Palme who called me. He was then the leader of the opposition. He became prime minister later, and I had been prime minister before. He asked me whether I could join him in the mediation in Iran-Iraq. He had been asked by the Secretary General to mediate. And he called me, and I was then head of the African-Asia Department of the Foreign Ministry, working under Foreign Minister Ola Ullsten, at that time leader of the Liberal Party. And I said to Olof Palme, wonderful, I congratulate you. It's good that we have Swedes in the UN mediation. But I have to think about this. First of all, I am working with the foreign minister, and how could I combine the two? Being head of the Africa-Asia department and doing the mediation, being the go-between between the Swedish mediator and the UN and New York, the Security Council and Secretary General, and the Iranians and Iraqis. I thought that was a rather demanding task. Palmer said, I thought about that. So I called the close then last night, the preceding night, and we agreed. We found a formula. Oh, what kind of formula, I said. Well, we thought that you could do both jobs. Very good. Then I did the trick that many of you women and girls supply. I tried to play hard to get. So I said, well, it's not enough that you talk to Ullsten. I have to talk to my wife. Then I thought for a while, he said you should say that I've talked to your wife also, but fortunately he hadn't. So I said, I'll have to talk to Kerstin, because it's a family thing too. We have kids at home and travels and some parents on the road, so to speak. And then he said, yes, I understand you, Lisbeth, my wife would say the same. But could you do it rather quickly? Well, I say a day or two. No, that doesn't work. You and I have a press conference at 10 o'clock. And you are booked on the flight to New York at 10:40 tomorrow. And we are seeing the Secretary General tomorrow afternoon at the arrival. So there wasn't much of a decision point on that. Since then I have worked with mediation, actually six mediations, and they were described by Karin in this book, where Peter Wallenstein has made my work so much more systematic than I ever expected myself that it would be. I'm very impressed by the book. And mediation has been a little bit of most of my professional life since 1980. It's Iran-Iraq, it's Nagorno-Karabakh conflict, It is Sudan, the civil war in Sudan. It is Somalia. It is Burma. The government calls it Myanmar. And it is again Sudan with the Darfur crisis, most recently, 2006 to 2008. This is my experience. I guess before I go into the reasons of failure and success in negotiations and mediation, I just want to tell you about a mishap, something once that brought me to a moment of consternation and wondering whether I was in the right place. It says on my CV, which probably you can verify, that I have a long experience in conflict resolution and mediation, which also Karin alluded to. And I haven't written this myself, but it's all over the place. And I was invited to New York when I was president of the General Assembly by a friend to an association. And I came there, and I didn't recognize the audience. You know, I feel in the room that these people have come to discuss foreign policy or mediation or whatever was my subject. But in this case, I didn't recognize the room. There were men in long beards, women with very dreamy eyes. I don't mind that, but it was a bit exaggerated. And then I looked at the invitation, which was in front of me, and it's a red A4 page. And then I realized what had gone wrong, and that I had got the wrong audience, because it said, they had sort of put this on the doors all over the place. Come and meet Ambassador, Foreign Minister, Foreign Minister, Eliasson. He is an expert on conflict resolution and meditation. same pitch. Don't get flustered, just keep going. Okay, my general point about mediation and conflict resolution is that it is basically very much a question of communication, very much a question of using the means available to convince, and that in fact mediation and conflict resolution capacity is basically a very human need, and that's what I would hope that you would find, hopefully also after this lecture, is that mediating well, negotiating well, communicating well is a basically needed commodity, not only in mediation, international mediation. I would like you to think about your own situation, both personally and professionally, later particularly, that you will find that these experiences, the reasons why you fail or succeed in mediation, are pretty generally valid, I would venture to say. And life in itself is a long negotiation. Have you thought about that? If you look at the private sphere, when you plan a vacation in the family, it's a long negotiation. You want to go alone, you want to go with family, you want to bring friends, what week of the summer. It's a slow negotiation that goes on inside the family. Many of you are very young, and many of you may have children, you will have children, and one of the greatest negotiations going on in a family is the amount of money that you get by a week or a month, that's negotiation. And our children, some of you were children not so long ago, you are geniuses in terms of negotiation. Children are great negotiators. Have you ever experienced yourself or a child asking for an increased allowance on a Monday morning when your father and mother go for work? No. They have a tremendous sense of timing. They choose Friday night. Friday night. Let's dance on television. Or scavenger, perhaps, if you want to play children. And so forth. Or parties. You're on your way. And then after dinner you sit down, parents, with their glass or something, whatever, feeling good, sleeping tomorrow morning, Friday night, thank God it's Friday. And then the child comes with his or her perfect sense of timing and says, Dad, My allowance is definitely under the level of my friends in my class. And then you feel very generous. Friday night, glass of wine at the side. Watch it, tell you. Sure, sure. So you go along without any problems whatsoever. And in your, but in your life, later on in professional life, you will notice that there is a constant negotiation about division of work inside a working place or the budget for your department or whatever. And not to speak about if you are in business when you sell or buy things, or even privately when you buy or sell a car or a house. So it's a negotiation all the time. So that's why I want to prove the point that my experiences in these international mediations hopefully are relevant for the whatever you do, more or less. It's pretty presumptuous, but I hope that I will prove my point. Okay. So let's then look at the reasons why you, I, fail or succeed in negotiations. I have identified four main reasons. One, the language you use, the words you use. Secondly, your sense of timing. Thirdly, your sense of cultural sensitivity. Fourthly, your own personality and personal relations. In these four categories are most of the reasons why you fail or succeed in negotiations and mediation. And I have some experience that I will describe. If we have time, I could add two factors that I have thought about later on, since this book was published. And that is, and Karin, you reminded me of that at lunch now, you need to have alliances also. If you want to succeed in a negotiation mediation, you need to identify your allies who can also influence in the direction that you want to go. So I would add a fifth category if we had time, or the question here, the importance of alliances. And the last point is the importance of media in today's world and communications. In the past, a diplomat only needed to know two words when he met a journalist. It was no comments. Today you can't get away with that. You have to be ahead of the information span and know that you set the stage, because perceptions are as important as realities. I thought I was pretty smart when I said that to an American media professor in New York recently. Perceptions are as important as realities, aren't they? That's pretty smart. And then he looked at me a bit condescendingly, a bit pitiful. He said, well, you almost understand today's media landscape. Why, what's wrong with this? Well, in today's world, perceptions are realities. You have to live with the perception. If you get the wrong perception out, you have to fight that, even if it doesn't correspond to facts. So remember that. So these two additional comments should be made. Since I am in an academic community, I wanted to be complete, but I will only now deal with the four remaining. Start with language. The word. I will now go through these four categories, and I will spend more time on language and the word than on the rest. So don't be afraid if you think that I'm dragging this out too much. I collect words. It started when I was 10 years old. I lived in a one-room apartment in Göteborg, Gothenburg, in Koltorp. We had a little bookshelf